Good evening, esteemed guests, lovely members of the virtual audience, and welcome to Orange City Literature Fest 2020. In the upcoming session, we have our guest, Sharmila Kantha, who is the author of 9 books, including crime fiction, business history, and children's picture books. She has curated and edited many publications on Indian industry and international trade, and moves seamlessly across across fiction and non-fiction genres. As communication lead for an apex industry association, she is also trying to keep pace with the fast evolving digital formats while keeping an eye on the latest detective novels. She will be having a conversation about crime fiction with Ma'am Madhavi Naidu within the next 40 minutes. Ma'am Madhavi Naidu is an artist, creates abstract on canvas, and has sold more than 300 artworks. She has studied English literature, is a romantic and loves Shelley, Keats, and Wordsworth, and often enjoys Shakespeare's creations. Madhavi has been the award-winning editor for Rotary Club magazine, Golden Orange. We're extremely delighted and honored to have you both with us today. And I, Anushi Jain, on the behalf of SGR Foundation and Orange City Literature Fest, welcome you today. Now, the spotlight is all yours. Over to you, Ma'am Madhavi.
Thank you, Anushi, for the lovely introduction. And I'm so happy to be here. So, coming to the topic, we have all read crime fiction all our lives. And like most mystery lovers, we don't really have a type. As a youngster, we may have favored Sherlock Holmes stories and intricate puzzles of Agatha Christie, then moved on to darker and psychological thrillers. We still go back every now and then to eccentric sleuths once in a while. We all enjoy the thrill it gives us and the mind games the story packs in. First, there is a crime, usually a murder. Then there is the investigation. Finally, the outcome or the judgment. Simply put, this is how one can describe our topic today, crime fiction. But again, to write it is definitely not as simple as describing it. So that is why we have here with us today, giving us insights into this genre, is Mrs. Sharmila Kantha. Sharmila ji, it's a pleasure and an honor to be interacting with you here on this forum. Thank you for being with us here today. And to begin with, I would like to ask you about your book. Human life provides so much ready-made material for a novelist. So we would like to know if this is true about your book, Just the Facts, Madam G. What about it makes it so real? And what about it makes it surreal? I know you're the wordsmith, but I'm just trying to play with words here. On to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Madhavi, and thank you, Anushi. And I would also like to thank the organizers of the Orange City Literature Festival for hosting this wonderful virtual event, which is, I think, gathering a lot of attention. And I can see that there are really outstanding writers, outstanding thought leaders. So it's great to be amongst all of you on this platform. As Madhavi said, we have all been reading crime fiction. I think today it's the most popular format of fiction genre right now, apart from perhaps romance. And I think romance nowadays is coming, second in the list. But crime fiction has in fact gained a lot of popularity during the pandemic times as well, because I think as we see more and more of chaos around us, we like to see some kind of resolution to the challenges that are there in our lives and end on a note that, comes to some kind of a conclusion, which is very satisfactory. But of course, it is far more complex than that. It is not just that we are looking for a resolution, because obviously it's not going to be, life is kind of, breaks off in the middle. There is no such thing as a conclusion in life. Or all the threads that are going on in life at a particular point of time. And the reason that crime fiction is becoming so popular right now is because we ourselves cannot relate to the kind of people who undertake violent acts, and perhaps we want to understand why. So as Madhavi said, it has become much more of a reflection, or it's like a slice of life. It is a It is an exploration of the both the perpetrator and the detective's background, their mindsets, the society that they live in. It's a reflection of what is going on in the society. So this is basically, you know, when I was, how I started my book, Just the Facts, Madam G, and its sequel, Business Unusual. I was working in a bank, and this was my first job, and it was seemed to me like a lot of routine stuff. You know, you went to the office, you did your work, you came back, and then you were struggling with cooking and managing the household and getting onto a bus and trying to make your way through the crowds and doing the shopping. And so the issue was that within this kind of environment where the whole city is kind of seems to be, you know, just upon you all the time, and there's so much you have to do and so much you have to deal with, like the traffic and lack of electricity, lack of water supply, you're getting up in the middle of the night to, you know, switch on the pump. How in the middle of all of that do you get some kind of entertainment? So my detective actually is pretty bored. He happens to be a bank clerk as well, because of course that is what I did at that point of time. I mean, I was not a clerk, of course, but he was a clerk, and his life was getting to be more and more boring. So he decides to become a private investigator. And the way that he does this is that he goes to people's different people's houses, and he sees how they are living, their kind of compulsions, their priorities, which are very different from his. And so that is what I basically wanted to show in my novel, that, you know, just hearing through different parts, different families, different preoccupations, and show the different slices of life in Delhi as it interacts and intersects with the infrastructure conditions, the daily chores of life, and the daily routine of life. So this is what my book, within that, he goes on to, you know, just talk to different people and investigate in some format, which is, you know, a little bit of lighthearted stuff as well. So it is not extremely serious. So, and then how he actually resolves it, and I try to bring in a little bit of violence, but it doesn't work for me because I'm not a violent person myself. So, it all ends well, and he learns a lot more about himself. He learns a lot more about the people that he's interacting with. And that was the purpose of that series of books.
That's nice. You mentioned, along with that, he interacts with people and learns more about you, himself. So is it something that you have gone through in your thought process, like while you're writing the book? Have you learned more about yourself while you're writing something like this?
I think learning about oneself is a constant process, and it is really interesting that I don't know whether this happens only to those of us who are writing and therefore who are analyzing things all the time, or whether it happens to people who are, you know, involved in other things like singing or maybe watching movies, etc. But in my case, I can never know how I'm going to react to things. And therefore, writing this book was interesting in the sense that I learned that I could stick with a format, stick with a style, and complete a project. I mean, that was something I've never done before. So it was quite a revelation for me.
And when it comes to your detective, is there any common personality between you and your detective? Have you reflected any of you in the detective?
Oh, yes. I think the detective is probably all entirely me, because he goes around and he passes judgment on people. And he does it in his own private world. He does it to himself. He doesn't say it out. And that's very much what I do as well. Mm-hmm. I go around watching people and how they do things, and how interestingly their perceptions of themselves are very different from the perception, from what they're, you know, the signals that they're sending out. So what a person thinks of themselves is so different from what other people see of them. So, you know, that very conflict is very interesting to observe, and I do that all the time, and I think that it has come out in Ramji. In fact, a close friend of mine said that the book sounds exactly like you speaking.
Very true, very true. So, and you have lived in various parts of the world, from Washington, D.C. to Beijing, and your hometown, New Delhi. So why have you chosen to base this crime fiction novel about the people in Delhi? Anything special about that?
Well, I grew up in Delhi, and as I said, I worked in Delhi, and therefore I thought I understood it a little more. But I have, you know, I was married, I'm married to a diplomat, and so we used to move around quite a bit. And Delhi as a whole, as a city, is so very different from, you know, other cities in the world that I have lived in. It has its own personality as such. Many cities don't have any personality. They are just all infrastructure and wonderful roads and probably good electricity all the time and water pumping at regular time. How boring can that be? So Delhi, of course, has got its own people. It's got the way people interact in the market among themselves, or the way they talk to each other over the counter of a bank, for example, or in a doctor's clinic is very different. I mean, people in Delhi tend to be a little more, how shall I put it, a little more wary of other people, a little more fearful and anxious about how their interactions with strangers might play out. So, and you know, that makes some of them a little more aggressive as well, because there may be a bit of insecurity on whether things will actually be as it is or not. So, you know, different cities have their own different rhythms, and Delhi has got its own very particular rhythm. So that's why I based my books here.
At the same time, now it's got this new name and a personality calling it the capital of crime with all that is happening. So what do you think about that?
I don't think that, being a big city, one of the metropolitan cities of India, it is going to have a lot more crime coming into the news than maybe a smaller city would have. But the issue very much is that in Delhi, the people are much more careful about reporting crimes as well. So that's how it shows up in the data. But so the data will show a lot of murders and robberies and burglaries and rapes and everything taking place. But I'm sure this happens in other cities as well. And perhaps maybe if people are not going so much to the police, to the authorities, it may not show up so much in the data in other cities. So I cannot say we can call Delhi by any means, we can call it a, you know, capital of crime.
But when you were writing your book, so did you do any research on what is happening around you or any of the crime, real crime? Have you done any research or just based it on a lighthearted people's personalities?
Yes, I just based it on lighthearted people's personalities and not so much on what is happening around us in real life. And the stories that we hear, of course, are much more violent, much more heinous than what I could have written about.
Yes, that's true. And you've also written many other books, like A Break in the Circle and children's books and 3 books on Indian businesses. So this is absolutely varied and diverse. How do you shift gears? And among this variety, which one gives you the most satisfaction?
Well, I started actually, I've always been a writer, even in my college and in my student days, I was always scribbling something. In terms of publishing, it actually took place when my son was small and I kind of told him a story about a little boy who buys a farm and buys animals for it. And when I wrote about that, I sent it for a children's book competition run by the Children's Book Trust. And they actually took it on. So it was published. And I'm happy to say that after 20 years, that book is still in print and people are still buying it. And it was a very popular story because it told a lot about farm animals and in a very simple kind of a way. So that was for really small children. And when that one did well, I did another story for children, which was made into a very nice picture book in which a couple of children go out to buy a gift for their father. So that also got published. And then I started on my detective novels in a lot of free time. We were based in Kathmandu and I didn't have much else to do over there. So I started writing this book and it went on through our posting in Hong Kong as well. And then I finally started showing it to publishers. One of them accepted it and it came out. And after that, by that time I had left my job because my husband was being posted outside the country, so it was difficult for me to retain my job in the bank. So then I looked for a job in some other place, and there with my writing background, they said that you should do some writing for us. So then I got into this business history writing, and the Confederation of Indian Industry wanted me to write their history, which is, you know, this year we are completing 125 years. So right from 1857, the business history, it was completely fascinating. I mean, the research work was so interesting. And
I'm sorry to interrupt. I didn't get that. The history part, it just broke the audio. So sorry. Can you repeat it? About what was it?
Yeah. I was saying that when I joined this Confederation of Indian Industry, they're a very old organization, and they asked me to write their history. And their history starts from 1895, and I actually went a little bit beyond that to 1857, when the British Crown took over the administration of the country. And it was really fascinating to see how Indian businesses had evolved over the colonial period, after independence, in a very difficult times. And how enterprises and businesses had actually had to keep restructuring themselves in line with the different aspects of economic growth, the different periods of economic growth that we saw over the country, over the years in the country. And I found that really fascinating, and I've remained with the Indian industry since then, and worked on other books for them as well.
So when you're talking about history and colonial time and later, so obviously we read a lot about it now that, you know, we were, you know, exploited, and in our industry was exploited. So in your research, did you find anything of that kind? You felt something like that in this particular industry that you were researching on?
Yes, quite definitely. I mean, there was... the British way of doing things was essentially to get the British economy going rather than the Indian economy. And as you know, over India used to be one of the largest economies in the world before the British colonization. And after that, we ended up as one of the poorest economies in the world. In fact, one of the papers that I read at that time, it's referring to some a conversation where they said that free trade was actually only for the British, it was not for the Indians. On the Indian side, they imposed all kinds of restrictions on businesses who did not purchase, the government did not purchase goods from Indian businesses, they did not allow Indian industry to do well, or their capital constraints were there. So all these things, it really, they left India in a very deplorable economic state. So by the time of independence, it was a depleted economy which had to really struggle very hard. And it is to the credit of all our subsequent governments that they managed to come to this pass where we are a strong, vibrant economy today.
I know we are totally deviating from the topic, but that was interesting because it was quite a bit of research to go back 100 years and see how the industry worked then and now. So that's, I guess we have to take it up in another session. But we are coming back to crime fiction. What are your thoughts on OTT platforms and the various crime fiction series made in India, such as Mirzapur and Sacred Games? Have you seen any of them?
No, they are a little bit too violent for my taste. I find that in India, what has happened to crime fiction, it is more on the screen rather than in the written word so far. I mean, crime fiction in terms of writing has not taken off so much until very recently. And the way that people look at violence and villainy, they prefer to do it in the movies rather than in the books. Maybe because we are more used to chaos and violence arising from poverty than the books that are written by the Western authors, which most of us actually do read, but which are actually quite different from what we actually experience in India as such. So it is possible that, as and when India's economy is growing and incomes rise and things become much more stable, we can expect that crime fiction readership will increase, which is already happening. But on the OTT platform, we've had, of course, in television earlier, a lot of serials like Bhokesh Bakshi, and others. But it was more of the British or the American crime series, CSI and other, The Murder, She Wrote, etc., that we used to watch more often. So this, on the OTT platform, when this has come, it is interesting to see that crime is actually featuring a lot more on it than it used to earlier. And series like Mirzapur or Sacred Games are basically extensions of the kind of movies that we were seeing and watching earlier. Amitabh Bachchan, Angry Young Man kind of movies. So not mysteries, but more of hardcore, what I would say, crime. No, those are not mysteries in the sense that you can see people committing crimes. So it is not that somebody is solving something as it is in the British or the American television series.
Yeah. This is more what I would say or think, but I don't know if you think the same way, that whether they are actually reflecting society and content driven, or are they being made scandalous for the sake of it, where you look at, the language or whatever is featured. So do you think it's content driven now, what is coming on TV?
It is probably a perception to begin with. It begins like that. There is a perception from the movie makers or the OTT platform serial makers that such a movie, such content will capture people's imagination and will be popular. So they put it out like that. And then what happens is that it actually does become popular, because the ones that you have described, for example, those are immensely popular series. So then it encourages people to make more and more of those series. And that is how it kind of goes. So it's until the viewers are watching those kind of serials, they will continue to be made. So it is, a kind of an interaction between the movie makers and the audience in terms of what is getting made and put onto the OTT platform. And I think we will see more of less violent kind of, more of drama serials. For example, Delhi Crime, which has just been nominated for an international Emmy Award, nominated or actually won something. That was such a well-made serial, because it was, although it was based on a real crime, but the way that it was done was much more true to life, and it led a lot of us to go back to what happened in December 2012 in Delhi, which was a completely an earth-shattering moment for many of us who had never dealt with rape as a public issue earlier. And the way it was made, the characters of the police people who were investigating the crime, it was very well done. So I think we will see more and more of those kind of serials, maybe police procedurals, a nitty-gritty part of it, but not so violent as, for example, Mirzapur or Sacred Games.
About the violence part of it, like, do you think all these Western series or books where they talk about serial killers, which was not so popular, or it wasn't, most people weren't even aware of something like that in India, which is coming into our OTT platforms now as Indian crime fiction. So do you see that kind of writing even in the crime fiction writers in India?
I haven't noticed so much among Indian writers about the serial killers as such. Because when you are looking at serial killers, there is much more of police kind of fiction, which so far has not come out very well in the Indian crime fiction genre as such. Whereas in the Western world, police procedurals are a very different kind of, I mean, they're a subgenre by themselves. So there is a lot more serial crime taking place and a lot more people investigating those kind of crimes, more from the police angle, from the actual police procedural angle, where they use crime the data, etc. So that has become, it is there a lot more in the Western world than in India.
So if you would compare the crime fiction authors in India to the Western world, at least in English, so how would the comparison be?
I think the...
At the present, the present writers.
Yeah. So but the I haven't read that many Indian crime fiction writers, and one of the reasons is that whereas I did pick up a few, I found that the depth and the characterization, not so much the plotting is very good in the Indian novels as well, but the characterization is somewhat different than in the Western kind of novels. In the Western novels, there is much more focus on the protagonist, the person who is investigating the crime, his problems or her problems, her life and daily life, and issues here and there, which are also very fascinating. I mean, they are part of the entire story, especially in the in the serialized fiction, where they have one particular protagonist investigating a lot of different crimes. So there you are able to see the progression of the detective as well. Whereas in India, that has not happened so much because we don't have that many series coming up. This is a comparatively new genre in India. And when it comes to publishers, they are also still not really sure about taking on such books, crime fiction books, and they are not very comfortable taking them on as fiction stories as well, and especially not in terms of serializing it. Although, of course, we do have a lot of people like Kalpana Soundarajan, etc., who have developed entire series on different different protagonists. But I think somewhat more the crime fiction genre in the Western world is a little more mature than we are at this point in time.
So I'd like to ask, what is the next book you're working on? And on an average, how long does it take for you to complete one?
Well, it doesn't take me very long to write a book. I write for a living nowadays, so it's very easy for me to write. The more difficult thing is to find the right publisher who will take on the book, and then the editing process, etc. That takes a long time. So by the time you start, you put your pen to paper and then you start writing a book, it takes me, say, about 6-7 months to write, and then it goes on with the process. It takes at least 2.5 years or so, 3 years perhaps, before the book actually sees the light of day. So currently I'm not working on anything, but my two books have been taken on for exploring the OTT world, and let's see if they actually manage to see the light of day as serials. But if that happens, then I would continue to write on my Just the Facts, Madam G, and the sequels to that, actually.
Would you be open for it to become a Bollywood thriller or made into a series?
Yeah, well, it was not written with that in mind. And therefore, what happens is that probably, you require a very inspired screenwriter, scriptwriter to turn it into a thriller or a series, actually. But I'm hopeful that it will happen. And then, of course, if one was to think of writing, for the OTT platform, then one has to write in a very different kind of a way. It has to be much more action-based rather than observation-based, much less judgmental, for example, and much less an observation of people's characteristics, character, or the environment, because all those are things that are visually apparent in a serial. So therefore, you need to put in much more action and less of characterization in such kind of writing.
So, which Bollywood hero would you see as your detective? Just for fun.
Just for fun, yeah. Probably a Nawazuddin. I
Siddiqui?
think, yeah, probably.
Ah,
Because
he is a
he
brilliant
represents
actor.
a kind of an ordinary person, and it's kind of normal, not like
Normal.
not
And a
like
brilliant
someone.
actor.
Yeah, and of course he's a fantastic actor. I mean, he can sink into his roles. He can't figure out it's the same person.
Yeah.
So, but
So.
the other youngsters are full of muscles, which would not fit my character at all.
So, at this point, maybe on a lighter vein, I would like to ask you some fun questions. Ready?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
So, if you could invite three crime fiction writers for tea, who would they be and why? Anyone?
Yeah. First, I think one of my favorite writers was Lawrence Sanders, who wrote really, really extraordinary books, which nobody is reading right now. But I would like people to go back and read those. Of course, he passed away some time back, so I can't really invite him for tea. But there is another writer, again, who's passed away, Dick Francis, who wrote these very interesting books on British jockeys investigating crimes. So, I mean, he wrote many, many books on that topic and that particular environment. So, it's interesting to see how he managed to maintain the interest of readers on just centering around that one particular topic. And of course, always on my list would be Agatha Christie, because she's the person who kind of set crime fiction on a very popular format ultimately.
Have you been influenced by her?
Oh yes, definitely. I mean, the cozy mysteries series, where everything is very fine and gentle, and there are allusions to things, and there are clues being scattered around, many of which are red herrings. All that thing actually comes from Agatha Christie. I think for all of us now,
Yes,
as
true.
characters.
That's true. That's true. Childhood favorite. Yeah. So, what is the one crime thriller that is your all-time favorite? Like, you can read it like 10 times.
Oh, I can't read crime thrillers 10 times. But the one that I really liked recently was this new book, Where the Crawdads Sing. And that is written by actually a biologist who wrote about the coming of age of a very poverty-stricken girl in a particular ecosystem, a particular environmental context. And there is a crime in it. But as I mentioned earlier, the crime is just, it's the mystery part of it. But the whole story is about this girl, young girl, how she manages, how she comes of age, how she goes on to become a very noted biologist herself. So it was written very well. So I really enjoyed that. It has
So
been on
most
the top of the New York Times bestseller list for a long time.
so more of an emotional drama with a little mystery put in.
That's right, yes.
Yeah.
And
And
of course,
if
there is also Nora Roberts, who's a romance writer essentially, but she's also written a lot of crime fiction, which marries together romance as well as suspense, which is a very good combination, I think.
Yes, it is. It is always. So, being a crime fiction writer, does it make you paranoid at times? For example, if you're home alone and you suddenly imagine all sorts of things or situations that could arise and imagine ways to solve them or something like that?
Oh, well, it's just scary. I mean, because in a lot of crime fiction, people entering stealthily through windows and balconies is very much a
Yes.
fact of life. So you tend to worry about the noises in the dark. Fortunately, these days of the pandemic, you don't find yourself alone at home very often. So those anxieties at least are fewer right now.
Yeah. So what's the worst scenario you ever imagined?
Oh, there's somebody coming through my door.
So, which book are you currently reading?
Currently, I'm not reading anything. Yeah, I am reading actually three books on Indian foreign policy written by our previous foreign secretaries and foreign minister right now. So, you know, it remains on my table, bedside table, and I pick up a few. They are so well written and they're so different from, you know, fiction. They are also like stories about how Indian foreign policy evolved over the years. And the analysis that goes behind it is really wonderful to read.
And have you binge watched any thriller on TV, OTT or something like that?
Yes, recently I watched Shetland and Broadchurch, which is practically Yeah, Broadchurch was one of the best series I've ever seen, actually. I really enjoyed it. And I started watching The Crown and I found that the detective in Broadchurch is the same as Queen Elizabeth right now. So that was quite a revelation because it's so different. Both the different series, but Broadchurch was very well done.
It's a psychological thriller and dark. Yes. So, is that something that you would like to venture in if you've liked something like that?
No, that requires a lot of capability in writing because you have to be able to understand the pace of the novel and bring in suspense, from time to time. So, well, let me see. I can try it sometime. I'm sure it will not be off of my list. I prefer to do lighthearted stuff, actually.
What about a career in writing books? What can you tell our youngsters about it? How to go about it or how to start or what it takes to write?
What it takes to write, essentially, I find a lot of people have a problem with sit down and write a couple of paragraphs and then the book is put on the back burner for weeks and weeks. But the only way that something can be written is actually by sitting down and devoting time at your desk for 3 hours, 4 hours, whatever it is you have time for, and then just sit down and write whatever is possible. And the editing can always come later. First you have the story, and then you go back and edit it, and then you edit it again, and then you edit it again. And after that, the issue is how to get in touch with publishers to publish it. Of course, nowadays, people are not going in so much for physical books, but people are able to publish books by themselves on Kindle, and some of those are doing very well. People who are young writers who write and put up their books on Kindle or electronic platforms, they are able to find a lot of readers, and those books are actually doing rather well. So I would think that one can bypass publishers, but it is always better to go to a publisher who is able to give you feedback on the book, tell you the kind of editorial mistakes that you're making, and where you may need to change the plot or the character or something like that.
So I think we're almost at the end of our session. I think a couple of minutes. So finally, could you give a reader some tips on how one can get back into the habit of reading, which seems to have been totally lost in today's age of screens and online content? So how do we tell our kids, how do we tell our youngsters, the teenagers, how do you inculcate this habit?
Well, it is something that one grows up with. So people have not kind of had books in their childhood, it is very difficult to get back into reading at a later stage, and especially when there are so many other forms of content and entertainment available to us, and it's very easy to just switch on your computer or your television and watch something that is out there ready made. But and the problem actually is that the books are not readily available to us. I've lived in cities like Hong Kong and Washington where you can just walk down to the neighborhood library and get practically any book that you wanted to read. And therefore, at that point of time, I used to read hours and hours a day. But nowadays, I don't want to buy books because they just keep piling up at home. I don't want to have shelves and shelves of space being wasted on storing books. But when you actually get a book, it's so, you realize what is the difference between having the story and being narrated in your own head and you interpreting it in your own way rather than seeing what is happening on the screen. And so it is, getting the access to the books is the most important thing, I think, for people to get people reading once again.
People did try that neighborhood library business. I think I've heard in some of the little towns abroad and all that, where they've kept their books outside and you can borrow it and put it back and things like that. But I don't think that would work in India. So,
no, my mother is a children's book writer, and she has set up, her organization sets up libraries in neighborhoods, and they find, or in schools, for example, and they find that it helps tremendously in getting children to read, actually. So that is a way that we should actually try and promote libraries.
Thank you, ma'am. It's really been wonderful. I really enjoyed talking with you, and I hope our viewers did too. So thank you for all your time and effort that you've given us. Anushi,
over thank to you. You so much. It was really wonderful to be on this platform.
Thank you.
Thank you for that truly magical, knowledgeable, and seriously amazing conversation. I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I'm like ma'am said, I'm pretty sure that the viewers enjoyed this conversation too. Particularly as a young adult, yes, this conversation was very, filled with a lot of knowledge for me. So yes, thank you for the delightful conversation. And I would also like to thank your publisher, Juggernaut, for all their help, and SGR Foundation for organizing Auron City Literature Fest. And I would really like to again thank both of you, ma'am, for accepting our invitation and actually conducting this session with us. We're very grateful that you're here. And lastly, I would like to thank the members of the virtual audience for attending with us. And I hope that everyone has a great evening ahead. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.
Twenty years of existence. Two universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Rice Only Group of Institutions. A vision beyond.
Thank you, ma'am.